So please join me in welcoming Ms. Katie Clark.
Well, that's very kind of you. Thank you, Tim. I appreciate it. It's a pleasure to be here this afternoon. Thanks. It's fun. You know, I don't know how many people know Naples, Florida, but we were just in the small group, and someone said, well, isn't Naples more of a retirement community? And I said, well, it is getting younger, but it's so nice to see young faces. Usually I feel young in Naples, which, you know, is the exact opposite here. So it's great to be here. Great to be able to address you all. I've got a short presentation, but obviously would love to hear lots of questions. How many are from the state of Florida? Ah, fabulous. So lots of folks. So we're kind of working in some of your home turfs. So let's see. Kind of have just outlined a short agenda for today. Thought I'd start with a little bit of history, and I think Tim gave you a little glimpse of both Hallstatt and the Baron Collier companies, who we are, how we got started, and what we're doing today. Also talk a little bit about our private equity real estate fund that we started in 2010 that I thought might interest you all. And then I thought I'd do a case study of what I call my first child, which was my first big project that have taken through a full cycle. So I know some of you are interested in finance, some of you might be interested in development, some people might be interested in operating. So this is a project that started with acquisition, went through redevelopment, and then operated it for 15 years, and then recently in May of 2015, sold it. So kind of give you a taste smattering of all the different parts that depending on what you do in your real estate career, you may specialize in one or some of them, or you may end up being somewhat like myself, as I was telling some of the gentlemen this afternoon. You can also be the quarterback and you know, help to make sure all of the pieces of the puzzle come together to really create something pretty special. So, let's see, sorry. So history of Hallstatt and Baron Collier companies. I think as Tim mentioned, my great grandfather was an industrialist kind of at the same time as Rockefeller, not that he was as wealthy as Rockefeller, but in that same time era, and Standard Oil, and a number of those times. And he actually was a self-made man from Memphis, Tennessee, and ended up making his way to New York City and built a fortune in what was called card advertising. That's the modern day subway and bus advertising that we all see when we're in a large metropolitan area. He used to deal with the Wrigley's, go all the cable cars. Throughout all the big metropolitan areas out to San Francisco and so on. And as you did back then, as you amassed some wealth, you started dabbling in a number of other businesses. He owned a ride, you don't own the whole park at the time, at Coney Island. So he owned a roller coaster. He owned a peroxide company. So those of us who want to be blonde can all go blonde. And then he came down to visit a friend in Yuseppa, fell in love with Southwest Florida, and his friend said, well, you love it this much, you want to buy it? He said, sure. So he bought Yuseppa Island, and he liked the west coast of Florida because he really thought in 1911 the east coast was too developed. Flagler had already arrived. You know, that was just known territory. He felt like the west coast was much more of a frontier, and he clearly was a tremendous entrepreneur of his own time. So after he bought Yuseppa, he just kept buying. This was kind of his hobby. He really enjoyed it, didn't spend a lot of time here. But what he did do was, at the time, US 41, also known as the Tamiami Trail, stopped at what was the Lee County line. It went from Tampa to the Lee County line, which is where Fort Myers is, so it came down the coast. And it didn't connect to Dade County, and that's Tamiami. It's called the Tamiami Trail because it's from Tampa to Miami. And that was the one major north-south throughway, roadway on the west coast of Florida. So he guaranteed the bonds that the state posted, and he actually organized and built the Tamiami Trail from the Lee County line to the Dade County line through all the swamp. If you've ever driven across 75 between the two coasts or along 41, it was pretty tough going. So that just kind of fun novelty notes. The picture on the left is a picture. He headquartered his operations for building the Tamiami Trail in Everglades City. That was the cable car in Everglades City. And Everglades City is this little tiny fishing town. So to think it actually had a cable car, and of course it had advertising in it, right? There probably was, if there were 1,000 people there, I'd be surprised. And then you can see that this rig over here, that he's the gentleman on the front. This is one of the rigs that they would take out into the swamps and help carry the supplies out as they were building the trail. So the Depression hit, the Great Depression hit. Lost a lot of things. What the family, what was left after that depression was primarily the land holdings in southwest Florida. If we turn the clock ahead, we were always a family that was very rich in land and poor in cash. How do we pay taxes? Okay, let's sell a piece of land. Okay, someone needs a little something. Okay, what can we sell? So we were always land rich and cash poor. However, when they actually built I-75, where it connected the two coasts from Naples across to Lauderdale, which otherwise used to be known as Alligator Alley, little two-lane road, we owned some of the right-of-way that the state needed to build that road. So we started redeploying those assets into ag lands around the Immokalee area, which is about 30 plus miles east of Naples, is really the breadbasket of vegetables for the winter in the U.S. Mexico also brings a lot of stuff in, a lot of vegetables in now. But around Immokalee, it's tomatoes, peppers, cucumbers, squash, green in summer. Melons, cantaloupes, watermelons, and most of what is in the store, if it's not from Mexico in January, is from the Immokalee area. So today we hold about 83,000 acres of land. We have 10,000 net acres of citrus, which all goes to process. It all drink Tropicana, not from concentrate. Keep the Florida citrus industry going. It is struggling mightily, but all our oranges go into juice. And then we have also have some operations in sod. We have about 5,500 head of cattle, and we also do a lot of farmland leasing. We were in the vegetable business with tomatoes and peppers. We would grow and pack and ship them. But Mexico has really come into the Florida window. And I think, quite frankly, we didn't keep up in terms of those folks that travel, follow the seasons. So if you're in the ag business, you start in South Florida and you work up to Georgia, and then you can work to Virginia and over to Michigan. And then you also need some in California before you come back to Florida in terms of having your produce. And we kind of stuck in our backyard because that's what we knew. But that was a strategic decision that caused our obsolescence, I think, in that industry. So more than you wanted to know about ag, you didn't think you were going to hear about that, but it's land. Obviously, we're also in real estate development. We have about 1.2 million square feet of office and retail. We've done a number of big projects. The one that's pictured up there is the town of Ave Maria, which is a greenfield development out not far from the Immokalee area on old tomato fields. And it's a new town from the ground up. It's got utilities, it's got a water and wastewater treatment plant. We've supported the amenities, the retail, the university. Tom Monahan also, that is where he put his new university, Ave Maria University. And then we've also done a project called Mercado in Naples, which is a mixed-use lifestyle center, which had 330 square feet of retail, 120 of office, and then about 175 units, which we very opportunistically opened in 2009. So, but we came through just fine. So that's kind of Baron Collier Companies. That's the broader family. My family is part, is one of the family members of the Baron Collier Companies. But we have ended up, but the Sproul family also has what we call Hallstatt LLC. And that grew out of a piece of land that my mother had that she chose to develop. We were pretty good at entitling land. So we went through the whole process to make it, to obtain the entitlements to do a 54-hole high-end golf course community in Naples. And quite often the family would get those entitlements and then sell it, and she chose to actually go ahead and develop it. So she was, I think she has some of her grandfather's genes in her, and that she has some hoops fun. Let's go for it. So we did, and we were very successful. It was a 25-year project that has just come to a close in the last year, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. So my mom is the one who's really kind of launched Hallstatt, and we've grown over the last sort of 10 years and now have 15 folks working for us at Hallstatt. And we've diversified beyond real estate into an investment firm as well. So, and I think that, what time am I, just so I pace myself? Whenever I'm done, all right, so I don't wanna, one of the things that happens in a real estate development, a big project like Gray Oaks, is you spend the first half of the project, every dollar you make, you plow back in. You build the next clubhouse, you build the next nine holes, you build the next cul-de-sac, you build more tennis courts, whatever it is. And then as the project starts to come to the end, it's really when it starts to monetize. So we had proceeds from the project to start to reinvest. So on the left is a picture of Gray Oaks. The golf course and then our clubhouse. So this really is the foundation of Hallstatt. It's a 1,600-acre master plan golf course community, as I said. It has three golf courses, one designed by Bob Cupp and two designed by Clifton and Larson, and one of those was updated by Bob Cupp. So it opened in 1993. And has at build out, there's still a few homes being built, but we're almost at build out and we're at about 900 homes over that 25-year period. And the price range in the community is anywhere, 600 might be a little low now, but seven or 800 to 6 million plus. So real high end, lot of fun stuff. Have about 1,100 golf and sport members. And 120,000 square feet of clubhouse, pool, fitness, tennis, everything to make the lifestyle, to make you want to come and buy a home and be part of the Gray Oaks community. We have also been ranked in the top part of something that's called the Platinum Club, which are the top master planned residential communities in the U.S. So we've gotten some acclaim for that. And as as the proceeds started to monetize towards the second half of the project, we started looking at what are we going to do with those proceeds? And the thing that does happen is, as development goes, it's a little bit lumpy. You sell a cul-de-sac to a builder and they're going to develop that, so they pay you for the land, or they pay you some of the land and up front, and then you get some on the back end as they sell the homes. So you're like, okay, got to invest that. And then you sell another parcel of land to a builder, because we don't do homes. We don't build homes. That's like designing clothes to go into Gap. We can build the store that Gap is in, but we don't want to build the clothes or make the clothes, because that's a whole new, whole different business. So we design the communities, but we don't build the homes. So we'll build sell another parcel to someone, we get another lump. Well, and then 08 came. And he went, oh, blank. Crumb, what do we do? So we really started to look at our allocation of what we had and what we wanted to do. So we have a number, we kind of view our Hallstatt now as an investment company. We have a portfolio of liquid securities. We have Hallstatt Real Estate Partners, which is our private equity real estate fund that I'll talk about in a minute. We also do direct investments. So we do direct investments in private equity, LBO type investments. We have another arm. Does everyone know what LBO type invest? I should explain. Okay, so a private equity LBO is you buy an I'll give you an example of one of the companies in our investment portfolio. It was a family-owned business in Providence, Rhode Island, that made coffee flavoring. So anyone been to McDonald's and gotten all those coffee drinks? Well, they don't make those coffee drinks like from, they don't brew the coffee, and then there's a flavoring, which looks like a syrup, but it's not sweet, that is coffee, and they reconstitute that, add water and whatever else, if it's your mocha, kappa, whatever. To reconstitute it into that. So this company had a process of brewing and concentrating the coffee flavor, and then they sold it to people. Or if you have a vending machine where you put your dollar in and you get a cup of coffee out of it at the hospital or something, that's that same kind of liquid flavoring. So we have a partner that we do that with. Made a direct equity investment in that when he bought it. And then usually an LBO is levered up. So you have some senior debt, which is like a mortgage. And then you probably have some mezzanine debt, which is more expensive and kind of juices the return, but can also bite in the back if things get really tough. So those are sort of LBO types, where you buy an operating business kind of in the 5 to 20 million equity check, maybe $100 million value, and invest in that, and you have a plan to move that forward. And then to improve the business, you usually have a strategic reason for buying it, and then you exit at some point once you've achieved the plan that you put together. Search Partners is kind of like LBO without the high risk financing on the bottom, but it's small businesses. Those are equity checks in the range of sort of $2 to $4 million. So, and then we have venture capital, startups. The partner that we invest with actually has invested in a few UF spin-outs. Pasteria was one of the biggest ones. It was a bioscience company biopesticide. If you're in ag or in golf courses, there's something called a nematode that you really don't like. It eats up your plants, it destroys your roots, it kills your yield, makes your greens look all not nice so that your members aren't happy. And so this was a biopesticide to kill the nematicides. And that sold to Syngenta. So that's kind of the breadth of what we do. We're kind of unusual from that perspective. But I know you guys want to hear about real estate. So so Hallstatt Real Estate Partners is our private equity real estate fund. We found ourselves sitting around, because there was a lot of time in 2009, not a lot going, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And it was actually in our backyard at Gray Oaks where we had sold two parcels to a builder. He had overextended himself and got caught short and had filed for bankruptcy. And we saw one group, buy one of the parcels out of bankruptcy, and we saw that and we were like, we can do better than that. We know we can do better than that. So we bought the other piece out of bankruptcy. We bought, it was a piece of property that we'd sold for about $25 million. They put another $35 million of infrastructure in, roads, utilities, paver roads, as well as there were 16 units associated with that, and we bought it for $12 million in the downturn. So that's how bad it was and what you never want to have happen to you. So we bought that piece of property, and that got, we were looking at that deal and that got us thinking, well, we know we're really good developers. We know our stuff. We know we've done commercial. We know we've done office. And we're sitting in the epicenter of the real estate crisis in Southwest Florida. Can we do something with this? And the family had never taken outside capital. We'd had a gentleman join us who had a private equity background. And he said, well, let's see if we can raise some money. Let's just talk to some people, figure it out. And lo and behold, between our expertise and our track record and the timing, which there's something to be said for timing, we were able to raise a $100 million real estate fund. And we did it with institutional investors, mostly either family offices or foundations, folks like the Kellogg Foundation, the Houston Museum of Arts Endowment, the George Kaiser Family Foundation out of Tulsa, and some other folks. And we acquired 12 projects in Florida. We limited ourselves to the state of Florida because that's where the opportunity was. And lots of these folks in their portfolios were looking for exposure to the downturn, to the crisis, the real estate crisis, and weren't sure how to get at it. And so they saw us as a niche player to do that. And quite often it's unusual for people to come into private equity starting out as the boots on the ground and, you know, the nuts and bolts kind of folks to then go up to private equity. Private equity is usually trying to invest in people like us. So we kind of turned it upside down. We acquired 12 projects. Some were office, some were multifamily, some were infill development. So there was a condo project, and three of the buildings had been built and two hadn't. And so we built the other ones and sold them. And we're nearing the end. That was 2011 when we had our first close in July. And if the ones we have under contract go, hopefully we'll have one project left. And we're kind of looking around a 20% IRR and a 1.8 cash multiple. Sir?
We actually looked at
We did look at some Class A's. Give me 2 seconds and I'll show you a little bit more what we did. So once we finished that in December of 13, we closed on our second fund, which was $120 million, and we added a pension fund to our mix, Abbott Labs, their pension, and kind of the same kind of thing. To kind of let you know where we were in the marketplace, we found a nice little niche. There's the Blackstone and the Carlyle and all the ones that everyone knows. And they've got a billion plus, or several billion. So they can't deploy their capital in chunks of 10, 20, even 30 million of equity. They need the bigger project. So if it was a bigger project, we didn't do it. We found ourselves looking at some of those initially and decided we don't want to be in the competitive situation. We don't want to be competing against Deutsche Bank or whoever it was that was looking at the project. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have sort of wealthy private individuals, particularly in a retired community like Naples, but in anywhere you do, who they like to invest in real estate, and they'll do up to about a $5 million equity check, but after that, that's more exposure than they want in their portfolio. So we kind of fit right in between, in that 5 to 20 million. So most of what we did is not Class A. We did buy one Class A. Well, we have bought some Class A office, but they were also pretty opportunistic. So one that we bought was, I think it's 30% occupied in Orlando. And all of what we've done are sort of what we would call opportunistic. On the continuum of real estate funds, there's sort of core, which is stabilized asset, cash flowing, great location, not a lot of management. You're not redeveloping. You're not repositioning. It's plugging and chugging. It's just doing its thing. It's a cash cow more than likely. Core plus, you kind of got core plus. Okay, well, maybe if we did this and we did this, we can increase the rents 15% or something. And you might do a few things, might need some upkeep, or you got one big tenant space to fill, but once you fill that, you end up in the core category. Then there's value add, where an asset is clearly, it hasn't been maintained, maybe it's older, but in a good location, it needs to be repositioned. If you could get a few new different types of tenants in. So for instance, we have bought a number of Class B multifamily apartment complexes. And they're not the places where you guys and I are gonna go live. They're very working class kind of places. And they're older vintage. They're 80s vintage mostly. So they're 30 years old. They're looking a little tired. People have been eking the cash flow out and not always putting the capital back in to keep up the property. So that would be a value add. We come in, we put together a budget of somewhere between 3 and 5 million, where we do capital improvements in the project, we raise the rents, we stabilize it, and then we sell it again. So that's kind of value add. And then there's opportunistic, where it's a disaster and you have to just, retool, start over. It's a project that's got 20% occupancy, or it's a half-built condo project kind of thing, those kinds of things. So that's kind of where we are, but we play in that smaller sort of middle market field. Any questions on real estate private equity? So the main part, which is, tell me if I'm getting too long-winded here. I thought maybe walking through, and I'll try and be quick with this, a project sort of from beginning to end might be helpful in terms of how you think about a project and the different disciplines that it takes along the way. And so you might become an expert in one of those disciplines, or you might do the whole thing depending on what you choose to do with your career. So this is a buy it, fix it, manage it, sell it. So this was probably what I would classify based upon the other one, a value add. It wasn't a distressed property. kind of between value add and core plus, but we really did a whole bunch of stuff to it, so I'd say value add. It was a great property, great bones, amazing location, and we chose to redevelop it. So the cycle, as I've kind of outlined it, is you do your due diligence and you acquire it. You have to finance it. Then, because we were doing the value add portion, we had to do a master plan and rezone it. Then you execute that plan, you construct it, then you operate it, and you have to get it back to stabilization, and then you decide to sell it or not. We did eventually decide to sell it. So what is La Playa? You can see the picture right there. It's 189 room resort on 600 feet of beachfront on the Gulf of Mexico. So what was tremendous about that is its location. Well, it depends what your objective is. In our real estate fund, the life of our fund, we have 4 years to invest all of the commitments, and then you have to, it's a 9-year fund in total, so by near year 9 you should be exiting, and then you have a couple extensions. So probably in the 5 to 7 years. This was a family asset, so we held it for 15 years, and in truth never intended to sell it, because it was something that we just wanted to hold. We thought we wanted to hold for the family, and then because of market conditions, we chose to go ahead and take advantage of those and sell the property. Did I answer your question? So really, it's about what your objective is. You know, there's some funds out there that they don't sell things that often. Some of the core funds, they're in it for the cash flow, or if it's a REIT, a real estate investment trust, they're in it for the cash flow, and they're not, they may still sell properties, but they're not on a defined plan the way you are with private equity. So, you know, we're not a huge multi-billion dollar fund like Blackstone, so we get creative about how we can create synergies and value in ways that don't take inordinate amounts of capital. We have capital, but it's not endless. So we ended up buying this property with Noble House Hotels and Resorts, another family-owned company out of Seattle, Washington, who had at the time 11 resorts in their portfolio, kind of boutique-y. They had the management contract here when it was bought, and then we bought it 50-50 joint venture with our together, meaning our capital, they put in the same amount of capital, and we were pari passu, and our interests were fully aligned. So whatever decisions you were making, it affected how much they were going to make as much as it was going to affect how much we were going to make. And we really liked that because we wanted them to treat our money like it was their own and vice versa for them. What we find is when you put some different expertise together, not only from capital and alignment of goals, is that you get synergies. So we had local market experience. We had from Gray Oaks that I had shown you. We had extensive club experience and club operating experience. We had zoning and permitting, which is always a local thing. It's all about who are the commissioners and who's the director of planning at the municipality or county, those relationships. And then Noble House had hotel management and marketing expertise. They knew the hotel business inside and out. So put those two capabilities together, and really that's how we levered the expertise that the two of us had to make 1 + 1 = 5. We feel like we really kind of, this was a good home run. Not everything you do is a home run, by the way, but this one was. I didn't bring the the outs. So what did we have to do? We came across the opportunity, and obviously before you buy something, how you come across opportunities is kind of organic and a evolution sometimes. So we heard this opportunity was in the marketplace. We started talking to them. We had club experience. Nobody else was thinking about, well, are there beach clubs in Naples? How good is the beach access in Naples? How amenitized is the beach access in Naples? And actually what we were really looking for was, we had a golf course community that we wanted to continue to sell units in. But some people wanted to live on the beach. And particularly what would happen is that the husband really wanted to live on the golf course because he wanted to play golf 24/7. And the wife really wanted to be on the beach, so when the grandkids came to visit, they can just shove them out the door and go play on the beach and walk the beach. She could walk the beach and all of that. So how do you get the best of both worlds? You combine them. So this started out as something, well, maybe this is beach access for Gray Oaks. Well, at the price it was, the potential that it had, it quickly stopped being beach access for Gray Oaks and turned into its own project. So you create the business plan. When we bought La Playa, it was sort of a low three-star, right on the beach. It was developed early before a lot of the regulations. So you couldn't rebuild it today in terms of how smack dab on the beach you are. Anyone ever been to the Ritz-Carlton in Naples? So you have, it's a lovely walk, but it's a walk from this lovely hotel they have down through the grounds and then through the mangroves. It's actually about a quarter of a mile to get from your hotel room to the beach. You don't feel like it, but this is like out your door and on the beach. So the location was amazing, and maybe we could go ahead and turn it into something much more, a 4 or 5-star luxury hotel that could not compete with the Ritz, but come in right under the Ritz. So that was the goal, to see if we could do that. The other was to add a beach club. There's a fair amount of beach access in the Naples area, but what there isn't is amenitized beach. So if I live in, I think Naples has some of the highest number of golf courses per capita in the U.S. or certainly in the state of Florida. And so lots of people live not on the beach. And there really isn't, you can get out your beach chair and your cooler, which is what you and I would do, and get in our car and drive down with our beach sticker and set it all up with your umbrella and everything. Well, when you're buying $6 million product, you'd really like someone to do that for you. You've gotten to a point in your life that you're done schlepping, okay? And you can afford to pay to be serviced. And there was very little of that. So what we did was we decided that we would add a beach club component, which would just be like a resort guest, and the resort guest would be like a beach club member for a day. And the beach club members, if you brought the resort up, they'd be the same clientele. So that was the other objective in the plan. So then you go through all of the competitive analysis. Who's in the market? What are the rates? What are the pro formas? What's the comparison? What can you do to the property? What you think you can do? From a zoning perspective, from a construction perspective. And then all of the things that you generally need with a piece of property. You need a property condition report. How good are the bones? Is it structurally sound? Are all the mechanical systems about ready to blow? Or are the elevators going to last you a while? You have to get an appraisal to make sure you're not grossly overpaying, or you know where you're at and what you can finance, most importantly, with that appraisal. You got titles, you got survey, and environmental reports, because you don't want to be buying something that you're going to end up in litigation over what someone did previously, what they spilled. So I've done that. You don't want to do it. So that's all your due diligence. So then you say, okay, we're going to buy it. Yeah, we like it. We think this will work. How are you going to finance it? We kind of went through, and there's a fourth that I left off of here, three types of financing. We started off with our acquisition financing. we went with a local community bank, and they partnered with a regional bank that was across the state of Florida to get 50% loan-to-value financing. That was about all we could get, and it was also conservative given what our development plan was. And then one of the things in order, that same bank committed to doing construction financing for us, assuming that it all passed the credit committee again and everything. But it was contingent upon us pre-selling 200 of those beach memberships. So we acquired it, and then we had to prove out our concept, and then we could get construction financing to do the $50 million renovation that we did. The two other pieces, and I'm just keeping this under financing, about 5 years into the deal, rates were attractive at the time. They were 6%, and we were so happy. We said, yes, let's lock it in. So we went through a channel that's called the CMBS market, which is the collateralized mortgage-backed security market. It's where they give you a loan. So Lehman Brothers gave us the loan, or provided the loan. They didn't give it to us. We paid for it. Provided the loan. And then they sliced and diced it into all of those securities that all got repackaged into individual securities that were then sold to other funds or individuals or landed in auction rates depending upon the risk profile, which was interesting because that was a very specific vehicle, and they had a formula for what was required, and we had this thing called a beach club. And they were like, no, the formula is this. And we're like, no, we got this beach club. And they're like, well, we want guarantees. No, that's not how it works. So it was very interesting trying to put a more creative project into their, which was like a round peg into their square hole. We finally got there, but I'm not sure I would do it again. So we got up to 65% loan to value, 10-year term, fixed rate. And that's important because when you have a fixed rate, even though in the end it ended up being high, you know where the bar is. It's not gonna fluctuate on you. You know the bar you need to clear to keep your head above water in bad times, and that does become important. The last piece of financing I will tell you is the beach club. When someone would come and buy a beach club membership, that was actually a 30-year bond. So that went on our books as a liability, but we didn't have to reserve for it. There's nothing that required that. So all of that we got to take out of the business. So that was another piece for us to get our equity back. That may not have made sense. So what did we do to the property? On the left here, this is the property right there. I should have outlined it, sorry. Before we did anything. So there was, sorry. Okay. So there was this low-rise 3- and 4-story building here connected to a tower that was 15 stories. There was about 5,000 square feet of conference space in this building. And this is all a parking field to service that, and parking over here. And this was about 5,000 feet of conference space as well. So what did we want to do? We wanted to bring it up to that 5-star level. So here's the tower again. Here's the Crescent building. But as you see here, it's opened up. So we demoed 40 rooms here. And then we came across the street, and there's the outline of this here, that meeting space. And we added more meeting space and then replaced the 40 rooms on top of that. And then we built the parking structure to accommodate all of our parking. And where the meeting space was over here, we turned into a private dining room for our club members. So that was their space, and we made it very special and for them. And then we had to go through all the zoning approvals and permitting that we had to do. And I don't know if anyone's ever done any zoning. No, you haven't had the pleasure. So it's actually, it can be fun. But the biggest thing is dealing with neighbors, because the one thing you find is that, you know, we all have different expertises. And, you know, you may be able to envision what a car is going to look like, or, you know, what the banking product is, something like that. Well, we can envision what it's going to look like, but lots of people don't. That's not always common among everyone. So you have to explain to people what's going to happen. We had loads of renderings in addition to these. And we had to get our zoning to add the beach club, and then we needed permitting from the Florida Department of Environmental Protection, because we were so close to the beach here. You can see how close we were. And we wanted to build a tad bit closer, and so we needed a variance, which is always fun. And in the end, there were some folks in this building here that really didn't want it to happen, and so they sued us. So we had to deal with that. They were pretty unreasonable in holding us hostage. And in the end, we offered them beach club memberships. We had all this money at risk. We're like, okay. And the only reason that they started to decide to take our offer was we had the permit that we were going to do a new drainage pipe across this parking lot. And we kept telling them, we are being fair, we're being reasonable, we've shown you every which way to Sunday what it's going to look like, you won't be impacted. And they were clearly trying to extort something. And we said, we'll give you memberships. Well, that's not enough. So finally we said, look, we're going forward, we have our approvals. You know, you'll have to get an injunction to stop us. And we went and got a backhoe and threw it out in the middle of that parking lot and just started digging it up. And we got an agreement signed, because they were like, holy cow, they really are. So they got enough of what they wanted. They were trying to see how much else they could get. But so neighbors are always, and communities always bring you lots of twists and turns. So just a few construction pictures. That's where we're demoing the 40 rooms on the beach side of the road. I got the number wrong, it was 40. And all of that parking area now becomes, let me go back one sec. This is the parking area, and this actually has become a really special part of the resort, that this is a whole series of lagoon-style pools and really kind of special, and then there's a new pool out here close to the beach. And so we demoed all of that, turned parking into something really quite special, and then this is starting to build the additional meeting space and rooms. And the parking garage right here. Those are the footers to the parking garage. So the before and after. This was kind of the maybe almost three-star kind of room, and this is where we went to when we were done. And this is the lobby, the old lobby, and this was the new lobby. There was one more. I'm sorry. So we finally get all the construction done. It looks beautiful. The rooms are pretty. The lobby's great. Now we have to operate it. And when do we open? January of 2002. So September 11th, we're 4 months after September 11th. So at which point nobody wants to get on, or half the population no longer wants to get on a plane. Scared to death, what's going to happen, all of that. So you certainly have cycles in real estate, and this was one of them for us, and then 08 was another cycle. And some of that plays into your decision as to when you want to sell or not sell. So if you hold, you have to prepare yourself to go through the cycles, the down cycles. And if you want to sell, you have to figure out, have I maximized enough value to go ahead and sell it? Or if I hold it, how much longer do I have to hold it? And when's the next cycle coming? So, and we have a saying that pigs get fat and hogs get slaughtered. So you've got to strike that balance in all of those decisions. But what were our results? The average daily rate, which is the average rate over the entire year that you pay, and you have to remember, Florida has a high season from January 15th to April 15th when we could get $600 for a beachfront room, and then we have April 15th to November 15th when we could get anywhere between $149, $199 to $249 a night. So we did bring it up to that five-star level. We increased our average daily rate 86% from $181 a room to $337. Something called RevPAR, which is the revenue that you generate per available room. So that includes your restaurants, that includes the tiki bar, the pina coladas at the tiki bar, the spa, everything. And we went from a 104% increase from in 1999, the year we purchased, of $128 per room to $261. And the average in Naples, including all of them, all hotels in Naples, even, you know, the Holiday Inn Expresses and everything, is $136 per room. So we really were quite successful in nudging our rate up to about $75 under the Ritz. So we were really pretty excited. But we did own the property for 15 years, and the next cycle that came was 08. And we learned some pretty important lessons in that. First is always have a little cash around. That doesn't hurt. That certainly helps tremendously. But also, if you're holding a property or a project through the downturn, you can't, yes, if you're able to. Sometimes you're not if you're a public company, and this is one of the advantages of being private, is what's the balance between paying dividends or making distributions and reinvesting. And you can cut fat, but do you cut muscle and bone to make your numbers work and get to your cash flow that you think you want to be able to have or wish you had? And we chose we chose what we call the long view. We didn't throw loads of capital into the property, but generally, there's a reserve account that a resort customarily does, which is 4% of their revenues. And we continued to put that into the property. We refreshed the rooms. We did things that the customer would see, you know, new linens, new paint, new carpet. You walk in and you're like, wow, well, it's kind of an older building, but this is still nice. And then you keep your team. Because the key to operating a service organization is your team. We had a long-term team in place, and if they're firing on all cylinders and working well together and all working toward the goal of serving the customer, it shows in the results. There's no reason, if you looked at the true physical sticks and bricks of that resort, that you would think we would be able to get within $75 of the Ritz-Carlton that's been in the Condé Nast top five hotels for 25 years. Because it's an older property, and it's just older, But you get a team that makes people feel like they are the king and queen while they're at La Playa and their kids are princesses and princes, and they have an amazing time on an amazing piece of property on the beach like that, and they forget that, it kind of looked like there were 4 coats of paint on that door jamb, you know. So that was key, to not cut back too far. We definitely cut, but you had to ask yourself, at what point do you sacrifice the customer experience, which will then come back to haunt us? And that, it served us exceptionally well, because as Naples started to come out of the recession, the Ritz embarked on a $40 million renovation project. The old registry, Naples Grand, now it was the Waldorf, and now it's back to Naples Grand, which is the other big sort of marquee hotel in Naples. They embarked on a $26 million renovation project, and guess what? We did ours over 2-3 years, and everything was refreshed, and we were ready to go. We had the team, we had the service, and we had a room that people were willing to pay for, and now they had money to pay for it. So we were able to ride the wave much sooner and faster than other folks. So we met our goal. We got on Condé Nast's list. We were on Travel and Leisure's list, US News and World Reports. Bunch of stuff, got a lot of great accolades, which was exciting. And then our partner was thinking about taking a different direction with their company and expanding, and we only owned one of their 11 properties. And so if they wanted to kind of take a different direction, we said, well, that's great, but maybe that's not the best for us, so maybe we should look at selling. And I know some folks in here worked for HFF. So we contacted their Miami team, and then there's a gentleman in Tampa. And in 2014, resort properties were really, able to get premium sale prices. And so we decided to take it out to market. And we did. So we started in the fall of 14, pulled together all the materials, figured out what we would sell it for, spent about 60 days, I think more like 60 days, to do the offering memorandum. Then they put a teaser out there. We had about 20 tours of folks come see it, and finally closed the property in May of 2015. And the results, sometimes it's better to be lucky than good. I think we were good, but it's also good to have some luck and be in the right place at the right time, which is what I think we were. About 2 months after we closed, a couple of the professionals from HFF said, you know, you wouldn't have been able to get the same price 2 months after you closed than you did. The markets just changed. They shifted on us. So I'll take luck any day. And in the end, for a 15-year project, we bought it in 2000, sold it in 2015. We have a 15% IRR. And a 4x cash invested multiple. So we made the equity investment that we made, we got back 4x over those 15 years what we put in. So that's kind of beginning of nuts. We should have put up another picture. Nuts of La Playa. The one thing that I would add, since I know you all are students and might at some point be looking for jobs. I think we this summer may entertain a summer intern, probably not a full-time position. I think you heard me say we have 15 people in our shop, so, and they do lots of other things other than just real estate. They do venture and LBO and search and that kind of thing. So, if you might be interested in that, I'll leave that with you. So. Hopefully I didn't talk too long. So. Yes, sir.
With the private equity fund, I know you guys, you know, it wasn't really the game plan originally, so I'd imagine a good bit of your all, a good percentage of the private equity fund, you guys invest yourself. What percentage?
It was 10%.
10%.
Our documents say we're a minimum of 10%, or it was $10 million. And we were 10% on our first fund of $100 million, and I think we're 17% of the second fund. So that certainly gives other investors, institutional investors, that's a large enough chunk of capital to get their attention to say, just like we said about Noble House, I wanted them to treat our money like it was theirs. Well, Kellogg Foundation wants us to do exactly the same thing. So when you put your money where your mouth is, it gets people's attention. Some funds at this point, they've been so successful, they only put their fees at risk. But we also had capital to deploy that we were going to invest in two or three projects. And this just enabled us to create a bigger basket and spread our risk, as well as see if we could start something new and start a new line of business.
And also to follow up on that with, you know, say you raise, I forget the number you said for your first fund, say it's like $140 million, you know, obviously you're not going to find, you know, X amount of properties where you deploy exactly $140 million, but obviously that's something your investors would want, right, that you want all your capital deployed. Do you guarantee, you know, we'll make sure we get 85%, or do you just say, work with us here?
Nope, we say we will deploy your money when we think we have deals that meet our criteria and that will get the returns that we have set, that we have told you we are targeting. And, you know, in 2011, you know, we started talking to people in the fall of 10 and then kind of really pretty seriously in the first quarter of 11. And, I mean, we didn't know what we could deploy. Some people raised funds in 09. Like big billion-dollar funds, they couldn't deploy a dollar of that. There weren't, the system was so log-jammed, and the banks were so busy merging and deciding who was sitting in what seat and who the leader was and who was in workout and who was regular, that it took them almost 2 years to start cleaning. And, you know, the feds had to figure out how they were going to have the banks dispose of the non-performing assets, because because really all of them were non-performing assets pretty much. So they needed, but if they did that all at once, the whole thing would collapse again or be on the verge of collapsing. So they had to work through all of that. So it really wasn't until kind of the second half to third quarter of 10 that projects started being sold. And they started enforcing debt covenants and that kind of thing.
What direction is your company like currently going? What are you looking at specifically? And where do you see real estate construction going in Florida in the next few years?
Well, we're going to continue to build our fund. That is certainly something that we're looking at. Now, what we would like to do is go out of the state, expand beyond the state of Florida, and how we're thinking about doing it, we're still exploring it, is to, I think I mentioned that we like relationships and partners, and so can we find some best-in-class families in Greenville, South Carolina, in Nashville, Tennessee, or in some suburb of Atlanta, because Naples isn't a primary market. Some of the big funds did come hunting, but generally it was always off their radar screen. So can we find some other market like a Naples, smaller but a good solid market, and we find another family or best-in-class operator that would be our partner on deals, is how we're thinking about doing that. We've got objectives for each of the sort of buckets that were up there, but in terms of real estate. The other thing that the family is thinking about doing is you know, when you're a family business, you kind of think about, well, what are my kids and their kids going to get excited about that they actually want to continue to invest in the business and not sell it and go off and do their own thing. And so we are thinking about seeing if we can buy a new big sort of trophy, big or small trophy asset that is more that we hold for the long term again. Sir?
You mentioned that you had to deal with some litigation at the beginning of the LaPlaya project.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious, do you have a percentage on a project like that that you set aside for potential future litigation, or do you kind of deal with it as it comes?
We just kind of deal with it as it comes, although we probably should have. But yeah, if you're doing zoning, you can pretty much set aside something.
The last whole management contract throughout the whole litigation.
Yes. Yes.
Is that something you look for in a JV partner that they're kind of looking towards managing it as well?
Potentially. I mean, it depends upon where the expertise. So we had, but since they managed, you know, I think in the end they managed about 15 or 16 properties. And so we had an arm's length management contract with them, as well as our joint venture operating agreement. and you negotiate that kind of as if it were arm's length. And when we do joint ventures, that is what we look for. Yeah, because rather than us go out and try to hire someone who has hotel expertise, and maybe we get the right person, maybe we don't get the right person, and we don't know all the nuances of that business. We had never owned a hotel before this. So it was a great way to kind of say, we'll do this together. You have that expertise. They had never operated a club before. And while they sound like they should be entirely similar and piece of cake, there are nuances. So we were able to, we knew what those nuances were, and we didn't stumble over some of those the way Noble House might have just being a hotel management company.
Those fees are included in the
RevPAR
number,
I imagine.
Yeah. Sir.
Out of the 900 units, how many of them were priced at $6 million? And were there other price points for different kind of products? What is the split up?
There's probably not more than 5% that are in the 6 million. The bread and butter, the average price is, I think, about $2.5 million. So that's in Gray Oaks, the golf course community that he was asking about.
A lot of like the big banks and the big lenders have started to kind of pull back on lending a little bit and increase pricing. You've seen a lot about, you know, these shadow and private lenders. Mm-hmm. Who do you guys turn to for debt financing for the fund?
We don't have debt at the fund level. We do it on a project or property by property basis. It all depends upon the size of the project. We've used, I mentioned HFF. They also have, they do debt brokerage as well. We've used them for some of our bigger projects, also some of our own contacts. You know, the most important thing is to kind of make a market, so to speak. You need several people wanting to do that loan and providing you term sheets, because that's what keeps everyone honest. If you only have one bank, you're going to be stuck with what they give you. So, sir.
First of all, it's a very nice presentation. I mean, about the life cycle of a private real estate, private equity. But what interests me more is, you know, the thought process behind the setting of the goals that you were in the first place. So did you hire any consultant, or, you know, what's the logic behind how you came to such metrics that these numbers would be realized?
Well, it took us a little longer to get to the numbers we thought we were going to get to.
Okay.
But you know, you look at it. It, when you look at a project, you have to look at the risk associated with it, okay? To take something that had a average daily rate of 181 and get it all the way up to 366, well, that's a big leap. That's not a no-brainer. We had to get zoning, you have construction risk. That was a pretty high risk project. So generally something that's more development oriented, you need high teens, 20s to justify the risk for a project. If you have a cash flowing asset and you know you're just updating an office building, that's a lower risk, so you would expect a lower return. You know, you have a stable set of tenants, you're gonna update it, maybe increase your rent a little bit, but not double digits and way beyond. That's a lower risk, so your return is probably, if you're yielding 8 to 9%, that's a great yield, and then maybe by doing some updates, you get it to 10 to 11, that would be good. So it all depends. I mean, the market is interesting. There are cap rates, which is a indication of the yield and the risk, down around 4 and 5%. And, you know, I think that's because the rest of the traditional yielding assets, most of the bonds are yielding, you know, 1 and 1.5 or less. And money market is, I don't know if you get anything, almost 30 basis points. So it's all, did I answer that well? I don't know. It's kind of the risk that you're taking so that you can gauge the returns you should expect. And if you can't get them on paper, you're never going to get them in the field. And usually what you put on paper isn't what happens in reality, but you got to start someplace.
I might just throw in something you mentioned in our earlier conversation, mm-hmm. that part of what sort of drives you, I think, is you said you like to solve puzzles.
Oh, yeah.
These are pretty interesting puzzles you've shown us.
Well, I think I started out saying that, you know, you can be the specialist, you know, you can be the broker for debt financing and know debt inside and out. And we love those people. I like those people because I like them as my consultant or my resource or whatever. I don't know it inside and out. I know something about it clearly. But so the fun thing about something like LaPlaya or Gray Oaks or a little bit more of a development project or something that has a value add is they're puzzles. What do we need to do? How are you going to piece it all together? What's the zoning? What's the financing? How does memberships play? What do we think we can get? Will people buy it? I think one of the things I forgot to mention, we did focus groups on the beach club. We were like, well, we like this idea. Does anybody else like the idea? I have no idea. So, and you're building something, right? Something, people go, I get personal satisfaction from it. People go and enjoy LaPlaya and love it and get great service and would say to me, they might not have even known me in town, and would say, God, I had family who stayed at LaPlaya and they thought it was terrific. And I mean, that's just personal gratification that you're like, yes, we did it. It works. You know, all that planning and years of like toiling when it was horrible. And you're like, how are we going to pay the debt? And how do we not decimate the place? You know, so it's really, to me, that's a lot of fun. It's putting the puzzles together and how do you put them together to make something that's really kind of special and fun and neat. And, you know, LaPlaya is a little bit sexy, but you know, even if it's something less, you know, glamorous, it's fun putting the puzzle together. That's when you're more the quarterback than the expert.
Do you think about staying in the lodging industry, or maybe focusing more on developing some of the ag lab that you sold to the family?
Well, we have started developing. That's kind of the fund won't get into that, but the family has started developing some of the ag land. The town of Ave Maria was on some of our ag land, and that's a very long-term proposition. We opened, so We started talking about Aave in about 2000. We announced it and got all of our permitting in 05. Shovels went in the ground and we opened in 06. But we got all our permitting in 04. Sorry, we opened in 06. We sold about 600 units, maybe 450 units, and then 08 came. And we had pro formas that we were going to sell 600 units a year. Well, we're so excited because this year, 10 years later, we think we're going to hit 300 units this year. So those are really long. We were talking about this a little bit at the earlier session, that there's long plays, and that's a really long play. And you got to have the stomach to weather it, and you got to have some cash to weather it. But yes, the long-term plan for the family, I think we're actually about ready to go embark upon a real strategic planning process, because with the amount of land that we have, that's probably somewhere between 100 to 200 years of development. And do we really need that much? I don't know. So, got to ask yourselves. That's something public companies don't worry about. They're worried about next quarter. Sir?
When you sold La Playa, did you go and immediately take that money and invest it back into the business, or did you guys take it out, or what did you do?
It is waiting. Sat waiting. It is still in the business. We paid some bonuses and a distribution to the family, but the 98% of it is still in the business and is, you know, I think we have our personal perspective is that the market is at 06 pricing in real estate, if not a little bit above. And you're just not sure. We don't like to buy at the top. We're not, I don't know, that's just kind of how we've always invested. And so we're kind of waiting. You know, it's invested in trying to make a little bit of yield, but it's like this. We're seeing if there's going to be some opportunities in the next 2 years. But it's tough because you put cash on the sideline, you're not getting a return on it. So,
do you think once you did get enough capital, or not enough capital, but a different amount of capital, more capital, that you would turn into one of these firms that really seeks fees, that you would go for the bigger projects, compete with the bigger guys? Or would you stay in the opportunistic value add arena?
Yeah, I think it's hard to say, but so we've done 100 and then we've done 120. I think our goal is if in fund three we can get to 240, 250, maybe double 200 to 220, 240, I don't know. Not quite double the size. And that will get us outside of the state of Florida. I think we really, you know, because our money is there as well, we've been pretty investor friendly. In fact, in our first fund, our fees were 1.5% and 15%, so a 1.5% annual management fee and a 15% carry on the profits after a hurdle of 6%. And then in the second fund, the fee is on committed capital, so whether we deployed it into an investment or not. The second fund, we were like, well, all that fee does is it's like an anchor around your, you know, a lead weight around your ankle, and you're like, okay, now we got to make up that 1.5%. So we actually changed our strategy, and our fees on the second fund are 0.5% for committed capital, and once it's deployed, it's 1.5%. You know, we don't have a big shop yet, and we're kind of liking being small, but, you know, if we're really going to grow, right now we had a great return on our capital. You know, if the return on the fund is 20 and we take our 15% of that, you know, we're up close to 30 on our own capital, so that's really pretty nice. Assuming we can keep that up, which, you know, the market has been at our back. So I think that's something that the whole hedge fund and private equity industry is going, a transformation that is just starting. I mean, you hear talk about, at least on the hedge fund side, that Congress is really wanting to tax them not as capital gains, but as ordinary income, which that'll change the fee structure in a jiffy of all those great big huge funds. Because they, you know, that carry is a significant portion of what all those partners make, and to pay ordinary versus capital gains is a big difference. I think that through the downturn, there was some recognition that the people who got the wealthiest are some of the hedge funds and private equity folks, and I think people are a little discontented by that. So I think there may be more regulation coming, and I think you've already seen some, you know, someone like Carlyle can keep their fees where they are, but, you know, other folks are starting to dip their toe down a little bit because you got to provide value. So I don't think we'll go solely fee-based, at least not for a long time. It'll take us a while if we're at 120 million to get to a billion. That's a 10, 15 year trajectory, probably.
Perfect.
You guys have great questions.
No other questions. Thank you all so much.
Great. Thank you.